You called my name. chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter, I was an orphan. Now you call me a citizen of heaven.
Good morning and welcome to One Line Church. My name is Brad Prunty, lead pastor here. I am super excited about where we're going to be heading this morning. But first, if you're here for the very first time having a One Line Church experience, I just want to extend a special welcome to you. If you would, at some point in the next couple of minutes, if you would click the link in the chat, it's a link to our Connect card. That's a way for us to know that you are here. We would love to be able to follow up with you and welcome you to One Line Church. It's also just a great way to stay connected with us and hear about events and opportunities to engage with us at One Line Church. So be sure to fill out that Connect card at some point in the next couple of minutes. If you would, be sure everyone to connect or to check in on Facebook. That's a great way to let your friends and your family members and your neighbors know that you're celebrating with One Line Church. Many of them may not even know that we have this church online experience, so be sure to let them know that. Maybe send an invite or tag some people that you might want to invite here to join us. But also, checking in supports a cause, and this month's cause is our very own One Line Church food pantry. We serve families on Wednesday mornings, and just by checking in, your check-in will buy a food item to support families that we serve through our food pantry. If there's anything that you need prayer for, be sure to click the prayer box. We'd love to chat with you right now if there's someone you want to talk with now. Also, our staff would love to pray with you throughout the week, so be sure to let us know if there's anything you need prayer for. Later on in this service, we're going to be having a time of communion together. It's a moment where we focus on Jesus' work on the cross and have an encounter with Jesus, some reflection time. And so, real quick, if you would, grab some bread and some juice, anything that you have nearby in your house, and just hang on to that and have it ready for later on in the service when we celebrate communion together. Again, we're so glad you're here celebrating with us this morning as we continue our series, Get Off Your Donkey.
The story of the Good Samaritan is one of the most famous stories in the Bible. It's a story about a man who took some risks, got off his donkey, and saved someone's life. And it's still so important for us today. Every day we wake up, we have a list, things to do, places to go, and while we're going through our day focused on our own goals, there are people all around us who are struggling, hoping someone will stop, notice them, and help them out. In this next series, we're going to come face to face with this challenge. Get off your donkey. All right, stay donkey. Sit. I don't know how donkeys work. You good? I'll be right back. In reply, Jesus said, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho. When he was attacked by robbers, they stripped him of his clothes, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. A priest happened to be going down the same road, and when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. So too, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he traveled, came where the man was, and when he saw him, he took pity on him. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Then he put the man on his own donkey, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day, he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper. 'Look after him,' he said, 'and when I return, I will reimburse you for the extra expense you may have.'"
In 1972, a movie that many consider one of the greatest motion pictures of all time hit the theaters. Here's a quote from it that I think pretty much everybody will know, whether you've seen the movie or not. "I'm gonna make him an offer he can't refuse." See, I knew you'd get that one. Also, I apologize for my really terrible impersonation of Marlon Brando. But that was Marlon Brando, who played the role of the Godfather in the movie with the same title. But the main character in The Godfather was not actually the Godfather himself, it was the Godfather's son, Michael Corleone, who was played by Al Pacino. Hopefully most of you got that right, or many of you probably did. Pacino went on from there to become one of the, if not the, greatest actor of his generation. But did you know that Al Pacino was not the first choice for that role? Another actor you probably heard of and probably know was offered the role first. It was Jack Nicholson. Jack Nicholson could have played Michael Corleone, and that would have completely changed the story. Nicholson turned down the part because, and I quote what he said, "because Italians should be played by Italians." I don't know, Jack, sounds like an offer maybe you shouldn't have refused. But Jack Nicholson wasn't the only guy who missed a big opportunity like that in Hollywood. In fact, there's lots of those stories. Here's a couple more. How about this one? Han Solo, played by Harrison Ford. Harrison Ford was not the first choice either. Anybody know who turned down being Han Solo? Tom Selleck. I guess he was too busy playing Magnum P.I., one of my favorites. No shame. Big time missed opportunity. Okay, last one. How many recognize this guy? Gandalf in Lord of the Rings, who was played by Sir Ian McKellen. But does anybody know who this role was originally offered to? Think Bond, James Bond. Sean Connery, not only was Sean Connery offered the role, but he was also offered 15% of all the money that was made by the movie, which would have been more than $400 million so far. Connery said he didn't take the role because he didn't really understand the story. Let's see. A hobbit finds a ring. Evil force wants the ring. Hobbit must destroy the ring, and Gandalf helps Hobbit. And Sean Connery gets 400 plus millions of dollars. I'm not sure what there is to not get about that, a big time miss. Today we're wrapping up our series, Get Off Your Donkey. And we've talked a lot about one of the most famous stories that Jesus has ever told, the story of the Good Samaritan. And like we talked about a few weeks ago, we might not know this story as well as we think we do. It's not just a story about encouraging us to do good things for others. It's actually an intentional look at who is my neighbor. And it would be easy for us to miss the payoff in this story if we don't pay attention to a little interaction right at the end of this part of the Bible between Jesus and the guy who originally asked the question that led to the story. After telling the story, Jesus looks at the guy who asked the question and says, "Now, who was truly a neighbor to the man?" The guy replies, "The one who showed mercy." And Jesus says, "Go and do likewise." And when Jesus says go here, he doesn't mean as you go through your day, do this when you can. It means go, go now, live this way, and keep on living this way. The way Jesus says this, no way that the guy can respond by saying something like, "Man, I really like that Jesus. He's such a good communicator. He really gets me thinking." No, when Jesus says this, it's an immediate call to action. An immediate call to go and do likewise and keep doing likewise. And how does this guy respond to Jesus saying, "Go and do likewise"? Actually, we have no idea. We don't know how he takes this information. We don't know if he takes this advice from Jesus to live an incredible life and does something specifically with it, because it's just not in there. The stakes were high. Jesus challenged him to this incredible next step in his life. But we have no idea. And I'm kind of glad that we don't know, because I'm afraid we might be focused on what the guy ends up doing and not focused on what Jesus actually challenged. Because hopefully we realize what matters most is when Jesus said, "Go and do likewise." What matters is now we've heard the story, and what will we do? What will you do? Don Everett is an author, and I like him a lot. He says this, "I think there's something refreshing and honest and real about the words, go and do likewise. They're like a door flung open in the winter, ushering cold, brisk gospel air into the stuffy, warm house of cultural Christianity. They wake me up, they remind me that Jesus isn't just my blessed Savior, but my insistent Lord. They point to the wonderful news that Jesus wants more for me than right answers and an elegant theology. He wants me to get caught up in God's work all around me. He wants me to be, in one word, missional." That word missional here, especially at One Line, we talk about the missional practices that we do and we try to live out every day in an effort so that we may bless the world. And yet too often, rather than getting in the game, we sit on the sidelines and wait for something else or someone else to carry out the mission instead. And instead of helping people find their way back to God, we sit by and hope that people find their way back to God. So all throughout this series, we've been challenging one another to live the mission of Jesus. And the best way to live this mission is to be a blessing in the world to the people and places that God puts in our lives. We've challenged one another to live out the five missional practices. We've talked about it every single week. The first week we talked about the beginning of bless, B. And B stands for begin with prayer. It's as we join God, we ask him to lead us. The L stands for listen, as we open up our ears to know and understand the people and the places to whom we've been sent. The E stands for eat, as we share meals with the people, intentionally building relationships. And the first S, which Brian talked about last week, stands for serve, as we give of ourselves to meet the practical needs of the world around us. And I love the challenge that Brian gave us last week. Why can't the church be known for how we serve? I love that. Well, today we move on to the final S and bless. And it's not complete without this S, which is share your story. To bless the world and help people find their way back to God, the words that we use, the stories that we tell are necessary. And yet most of us hold back, and not necessarily because we don't recognize opportunities to speak. Do you ever get that feeling? Maybe like it's in your stomach, there's kind of this fluttering of, I feel like this is the moment, I should share something. Or maybe something's on the tip of your tongue and you realize this is the moment. This is the moment when I can share what God has done in my life, the impact that my relationship with God has had. Have you ever had that moment where you feel this kind of unsettledness? But some reason, something happens and we stop ourselves from sharing. Why? Why do we so often hold back the story of Jesus in our own life when it comes to sharing with other people? Maybe we've bought into the lie that I don't have what it takes, Nick, or we think sharing the Bible is only for super religious people, those who understand tons about the Bible. After all, what if a debate breaks out and I don't have time for all the answers, or I don't know all the answers? Listen, friends, I stand here in this moment today as a pastor and as a teacher, and I don't know all the answers to all the difficult questions either. So I have some advice. You can do what I do. What you should do is reach out to Mark Derry, mark@onelinechurch.org, and he will gladly take it from there. No, in all seriousness, we may not have all the answers to life's most challenging questions, but what we have is better. What we have is what Jesus told his disciples when he sent them out to share the good news. Listen to this from Matthew 10. It says, "Don't worry about how to respond or what to say. God will give you the right words at the right time. For it is not you who will be speaking, it will be the Spirit of your Father speaking through you." We aren't speaking these words on our own. If you're a Christ follower, you have the Spirit of God living inside of you, and that's what it takes. We have something better. Sometimes we have this other excuse where we don't want to share our story because I don't want to impose my beliefs on someone else. And we've all seen the stereotypes, right? Whether it's in movies or on the news or on radio, or we read about it. These angry Christians who have bullhorns and they're trying to jam the Bible down people's throats or scream it into their soul. If that's what you're afraid of, good, don't do that. However, humbly and authentically sharing the difference that following Jesus has made in your life is not imposing your beliefs on anybody. Donald Miller is another one of my favorite authors, and he writes a lot about writing better stories with our lives. He gives kind of an interesting take on it. I want to share it with you. He says, "In a great story, there's always someone who wants something, who has to struggle and fight and overcome obstacles to get it. So we have to ask ourselves, what do we want? What are we working for and struggling for? And would it make a good movie?" That's an interesting take, I think. Don Miller says, and I quote, "Bob may really, really want a Volvo, but who cares if Bob gets a Volvo or not? Not a movie I'd want to see about Bob getting a Volvo. Nothing wrong with wanting or getting a Volvo, but it doesn't bring us to tears when the salesman hands Bob the keys to his new Volvo. It doesn't send chills up our spine when Bob drives off the lot in his new Volvo." Miller says, "Nobody cries at the end of a movie about a guy who wants a Volvo. But we spend years of our own lives actually living that same story or something like it. And we expect our lives to be more meaningful than that. The truth is, if we choose to do with our lives and what we choose to do with our lives, if it won't make a story meaningful, it won't make a life meaningful either. Every one of us has a story to share. And so today, I want to leave you with three challenges. And the first is this, challenge number one. Let God write your story. Maybe you're with us today and you haven't had a life-altering encounter with Jesus, and I'm so glad that you're here with us today. Maybe today's that moment, who knows? And you're going to take that step to engage with Jesus for the very first time. No matter who you are or where you've been or what you've done, the God who created this world and created you and knew you before you were ever born wants a relationship with you. He wants to write a new story with your life. And so if you would like to take that step, I would love to help you. We as a church would love to help you take that step. All you need to do is say something in the chat right now, no matter where you're on, whether you're on Facebook Live or onelinechurch.live, just share in the chat you would like to know more or take a step more, and we will reach out to you immediately. If you're not comfortable with that, you can email me directly, nick@onelinechurch.org. I would love to talk to you about what it looks like for Jesus to help begin writing the next chapter of your story. And the second challenge is this, compose your story. And I mean, like, literally write your story this week. Take some time, set it aside, and write your story. And it doesn't have to be super complex. There's three really important parts when it comes to sharing your story. The first part is, what was my life like before Jesus? How did I meet or encounter Jesus? And what has been my life since I've known Jesus? Okay, just those three parts. Before Jesus, how did I know him? And what's it been like since then? And maybe you're even going, I don't even know where to begin with my story. And the truth is, your story is incredible. There are so many chapters of your story that should be and need to be told. But for this, for giving an account of what God's done in your life, it only really needs to be a couple minutes. And so for this part of your story, that's my encouragement. Just make it a couple minutes. Those three parts. Before Jesus, how I met Jesus, and what my life has looked like after. And Apostle Peter challenges us with this, and I think it's a really good encouragement. Why that 1 to 2 minute story would be really helpful. He says, always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give reason for the hope that you have. Listen, if you're beginning with prayer, if you're listening, if you're eating, if you're serving, there will come a time when somebody asks you about your life, about your story. Are you ready to share your story? Do you have that worked out where you could simply and easily share what God has done? So the challenge, the second challenge, is compose your story. Be ready to give an answer for why you have hope in your own life. And the final challenge is this, challenge number three. Ask God for an opportunity to share your story. I know. To carry out the mission of Jesus, we must use our words. We must use our story just as Jesus uses story. But would you be bold enough? May you have the courage to share your story. I'm asking you to take that step, to ask God to share your story, to ask God for an opportunity to share your story with those people and that environment and place in which God has put you in. Ask him for that. It'll take a little courage. But I know this is true. He will give you an opportunity to share your story. Jesus knew how important a good story was in communicating. He knew how important a good story was in helping people find their way back to God. And that's why he's always telling them. He's always telling these stories. But that's also why we spent 5 weeks as a church on this one. Your story is a great story. Your story is a God story. You need to go and do likewise. Go tell your story. Let's pray. Living God, Heavenly Father, thank you for the stories that you weave in all of our lives. God, I pray that some of us today take that step of letting you write the next chapter of our story. Rewrite our entire story with our identity. God, I pray that you give us the courage this week to set aside time and compose our story. And God, I pray that this week we may have opportunities to share our story with the people and the places that you have put us. Give us the courage and the boldness to share our story. I pray, Lord, that we walk away from this message different. That we walk away from this message and conclusion of this story that you've told, that we may go and do likewise. Help us, Lord. Give us the courage to go and tell our story. It's your name that we pray. Amen. Each time when we gather, we are very intentional about remembering the gift that God gave us in Jesus, remembering the sacrifice that Jesus gave to us so that we may have eternal life. We also remember the story that he has woven in our own lives, and we do that through communion, our opportunity to remember everything he's done for us. And so together today, the bread or cracker or whatever you've chosen and the juice, we're going to take these together to remember what he's done in our lives, to celebrate the fact that he's given us that eternal relationship with him. So let's take the bread together and remember that his body was broken for each and every one of us. And the juice that represents the promise, the eternal promise of a relationship with Jesus and eternal life in heaven. Let's remember his sacrifice together.
When the darkness falls, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. My God will never fail. Oh, my God will never fail. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. Every war he wages, he will win. I'm not backing down from any giant, 'cause I know how this story ends. Yes, I know how this story ends. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. Take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory, I'm gonna see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord.
For the next few moments, we are going to have a time that we call giving back to God. And this is our offering time, and it's a chance for us to give back to God what He's blessed us with, to take the resources that He's given us and to say, God, I trust you in every area of my life, and that includes my finances. And there's a couple different ways that you can give in this moment. You can give through the One Line Church app. You can also give through our website, onelinechurch.org/give. In both of those places, you can give a one-time gift or you can set up a recurring gift as well. Again, I feel like maybe a broken record on this, but thank you so much for your generosity. I continue to be blown away and inspired by your commitment to the mission, and every penny that's given is used collectively to help more and more people find their way back to God. It's been great celebrating with you this week. We will see you again next Sunday.
Get off your donkey. Get off your donkey. I almost wiped out for real that time. That would have been great.
You ready?
Yep.
Every day we wake up and we have a list. Things to do, places to go. And while we're...